Chairwoman Rosenworcel, first let me join with everyone else in congratulations. You've been a champion of public safety long before it was cool, and I'm looking forward to what your FCC has to offer. We have a systemic problem. In 2019, at the height of the California wildfire season, California's power utility, PG&E, advised the public that they could find out when power would be restored by visiting their website. And if their power was already out, they should use a landline to call a relative or friend who could give them the information from their webpage. Apparently, PG&E were unaware that even if people have landlines, modern networks are not self-powered. This anecdote illustrates a number of points I want to touch on. First is the vital importance of power to the modern communications grid at every stage. This includes not only power to cell towers, but power in the home. Second, this story underscores the changing ways in which we communicate in a crisis. Local governments and first responders use and often hear from consumers through the internet during disasters, including through video and audio. Finally, this story shows how slowly we've adjusted to these new realities. Our mentality around network resilience remains mired in the analog age. We're still struggling to address backup power to cell towers, an issue identified by the FCC 15 years ago, when we've done virtually nothing on backup power in the home. We need a fundamental change of mindset for the modern world. At the moment, each player in the communications environment is on its own, responsible for its own network hardening and response. The current wireless communications framework makes mutual aid and assistance a matter of last resort. The attitude continues to be, everyone is on their own. But one of the great strengths of our modern communications network is its redundancy. Rather than one wireline network hardened to maximum reliability, we have multiple networks that interconnect and interoperate with each other. Ideally, coordination and mutual assistance would begin before the disaster hits so that we can minimize the interruptions to vital communications throughout the crisis. States and federal governments frequently declare a state of emergency before a disaster hits so that emergency preparations can begin. Ideally, we would use the same triggers and should continue until the FCC shuts down DIRS. Changing the current culture from every network for itself to we're all in this together will take time. It will take participation by industry and government at all levels to make our networks more resilient in the face of increasingly violent weather events. I have listed recommendations in my written testimony, but I particularly want to stress the importance of mandatory roaming agreements for all mobile carriers on a billing basis as the most urgent and easiest change now that we are sunsetting our 3G networks and all carriers will use the same standards. I also want to stress the importance of making NORS data available to the public so the market can reward networks that invest in resiliency. Finally, I want to thank the chair for including consumer advocates in these discussions about network resiliency. Often these discussions focus on the cost to carriers of the resiliency measures, but consumers pay far more and all at once if they can't access communications during the crisis. And of course, consumers pay when carriers need to rebuild networks because they fail to properly maintain them or fail to harden them in the face of global climate change. As we can see today, the price of inaction is already too high. Thank you, and I am happy to answer any further questions.